Welcome. But I don't see anyone. I'm not sure. Irina, are there other people or are we the three of us? I'm sorry.
People are joining in the back. So there are 12 currently, but they're coming in, yeah.
Can you give me, because I don't see, how can I see them? Oh yeah, I see participants 15. Oh yeah, I see them. Welcome, everybody. Maybe we wait a couple of seconds to start this session about Dataverse adaptation to the European research environments. Let's see whether more people are joining. Oh, I'm sorry. Now, I think I will start. So this session is about Dataverse adaptation to the European research environment, and especially about translations of the user interface. I will give a short introduction. My name is Marion Wittenberg. I'm a task leader of task 5.2 of the SHOC project, and my colleague Laura Huizenetveld will do most of the presentation, and she is functional manager of the SHOC Dataverse. Welcome to this session. There are a couple of housekeeping rules. The first one is that the session will be recorded and made available afterwards. And please stay muted and keep your video off during the presentation. And you can ask questions in the chat throughout the session, and we will answer these questions after the presentation. So first I will say something and then Laura will continue, and then afterwards we will try to answer your questions. Now something is, we present you the work done in the context of the SHOC project. Task 5.2 of SHOC is engaged with hosting and sharing data repositories. This task is about development of a data repository for social science and humanity researchers. We make use of the Dataverse software. Four ERICs are involved, Daria, Claren, Iris, and CESDA. And we are building a mature infrastructure based on the requirement of the involved communities. And furthermore, we're investigating sustainable governance models, what should be done after the project is finished and we have a service available. And we also are training staff of service providers and institutes how to use the Dataverse software as a service. There are several partners involved in this task. From CESDA, there are the two service providers, DANS from the Netherlands and Austria from Austria. From DARIA, it's the Poznan Supercomputing and Network Center, PSNC, and the University of Göttingen. From Claren is the University of Tromsø, and from IRIS is the National Research Council of Italy. We adapt within the SHOC project the Dataverse software to the needs of the European social science and humanities research communities. And what is Dataverse? Dataverse is repository software for sharing and publishing datasets. It's open source software developed by the Institute of Quantitative Social Sciences in Harvard, of the Harvard University in Boston. And there are a lot of organizations around the world already using and contributing to the development of the software. And they are joined in the Global Dataverse Community Consortium. You get this presentation afterwards. So if you are not familiar with Dataverse yet, you will see the different services already making use of this software. For the SHOC project, We adjusting the data first software to the needs of the European research infrastructures. And what we are doing is, for example, we localize, we make a connection to localized PIT providers. We adjust the metadata to domain specific needs. We work on interoperability with domain specific controlled vocabularies and thesauring. And one of the things we also do is the development of a translation service for translations of the user interface in the various European languages. This session will focus on this last aspect. For this service, we make use of the WebLate software. This is open source software, which we have adapted to the needs of the SHOCK project. The translation of the user interface will be a crowd effort. My colleague Laura Huizenveld will now present the details. So please, I stop sharing my screen. And Laura, if you can share your screen.
I will. And I'll start the presentation. All right. You can see it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it in presentation mode? No, not yet. Okay, as Marion said, WebLate is open source software, and you can use WebLate. It's a helpful tool for translation because you can import your files that need translation and see them in the WebLate user interface. So with WebLate, you can work on a translation with the whole world or with just a selected group of users. So the main problem that it solves for us is that when a new version of Dataverse is available, WebLate can automatically see which strings are not yet translated in this new version. So this was one of the main problems we had. So you don't have to look at each new line to see if there's already a translation for it in the last version or not. Work? Yes. So WebLate works with the concept of projects and components. The project is just organized with components, and a project can contain any number of components. And one component is a one translatable files. So for our SHOCK Dataverse, we made the following setup. Our project is the Dataverse UI, and the components are the bundle and properties file, and one file per metadata block, and one solid file. So in this way, we have all the ingredients for the user interface. And each component can then be translated into several different languages. We have installed our version of WebLate on the SESTA cloud infrastructure. You can see the link here. Different about this version is that we have developed a plugin within the SHOCK task 5.2. And this plugin makes it possible to see the English translation as well in the user interface. And with this plugin, it's a bit more user-friendly. It makes the translation easier. So what does it do? We have configured WebLate with GitHub. It means that you can indicate which files in your GitHub repository are the files that need to be translated. And once you've did this, once you do this, WebLate will import these files, and then you can see them in your WebLate user interface. So for Dataverse, I mentioned these already. These are the bundle and properties files and the metadata block files and the solar file. So you can see that these are the components. And what's interesting about this, we have connected our weblay to the global Dataverse community GitHub. This is where all the translations of the Dataverse community are stored. And for each language, a new file will be created in GitHub. So if you create a new translation in weblay, it will automatically create a new file also in this GitHub repository. So these files are in synchronization. So if you edit your file and save it, this adjustment is also being saved in your GitHub. So it's always up to date. Well, this synchronization, we haven't turned this on yet because we're in testing phase and we didn't want to corrupt the Dataverse community GitHub. But once we are done testing, we can use this feature. And we connected it to the latest branch of Dataverse. So weblay will always check your translation with the latest version. So you can see if you're up to date or not. And the translation files of the previous versions, you can store them in the respective branches for the older versions. So our weblay is now using this access model. It's protected, that's called. So the project is visible to everybody. So if you go to the site, you can see it, but only a group of selected users can contribute. So only these users can save their translations for now. So if you are interested in contributing, you can make an account on our weblay site, and then you can contact me and I can give you permission to start a new translation or just to add to an existing one. I will show you now a bit of the user interface to get a feeling of how it looks like. When you start, you can select your language here. In this example, there are only two, but there are of course more languages than English and Dutch. You can also see in this overview a bit how much is done already. So if your language is not in the list, you can add it yourself. You can see from the image here, you can choose your language from the list. And not only French, for example, is available, but also varieties of the same language are available to choose from. And what's very nice from weblay is that if you indicate in your user profile that you can understand French and English, and you want to start a Canadian French translation, and then not only the English source string will be shown, but also the normal French translation can be shown if it's available, of course. So then if you do the Canadian French translation, you can copy from it if it's the same or not. So that's a handy feature. So if you have selected your language, you can choose the component you would like to start translating. I have a bigger picture here. So you will see an overview of the amount of work that's done already. And below here, you can see also kind of filter. So you can see the strings that need edits or that are only filled in with suggestions. So you can use this filter to go to these strings, or you can just click the translate button on the right. So then you will see this. This is the most important part of the screen you will see next. So you can see here there's a key. This is a kind of unique ID for the string. You can see the English string. And then below you can see a text box for the Dutch translation, because I'm translating in Dutch, so I made this screenshot example. You can then choose to save your translation, to do a suggestion, or so you can take a look at it later, or someone else can take a look if you do a suggestion, or you can skip it, leave it empty, and go back later and try to look at it again. So Weblate comes with a different multiple handy features, and one of them is a glossary, and it's what you see here. So the glossary is comes in handy when you have a term that occurs often within your files. So for example, unrestricted in this screenshot. So if you want users to use the same translation for this word when there are maybe several synonyms, you can use the glossary for this. You can save, if there is a word that has two different translations and you only want to use one to be consistent in your user interface, then you should save only this one term in your glossary. And this shows that Weblate is really a community tool, because, well, Weblate doesn't fill this in automatically. So someone needs to, needs to add this to the glossary. So if you're working with a group of people on a translation, it would be very nice if everyone would contribute to this glossary so that all the rest of the team can, they can use this as well. So I have two other examples of that, because here you see on the right a screenshot context. You can add a screenshot to strings. So if you are having trouble with translating because you're not sure what the context is of a sentence, the best way probably is to look it up to see if you can find it in the user interface. So once you've done that, it would be a good idea to save this in Weblate. So once you've saved this, this screenshot will automatically be displayed also for the other languages, so that other people won't have the same problems as you had. And well, the other example here is the explanation on the left. This is just a text box where you can provide some context for the string. So that are just helpful features of Weblate. Well, we have some to-dos. We haven't tested all the full potential, I think, of Weblate. We should decide on the review process, because you can also decide on a workflow in which one reviewer will finalize the translation. So this one reviewer or two is the only one who can really make the definite decisions about translation. You can also work with voting for suggestions, so people can only do suggestion. And if you have three same suggestions, then you can say, okay, three people have named the same translation, so this should be it. There's also some more you can do: automatic checks, and we still have to look into that. And then one big thing is that we have to test with the translation of the Solr files, because we will need to transform them first into another format in order for Weblate to import it. So we have to see how that goes, if it works smoothly or not. And for this, well, for these decisions, for example, we will organize training sessions. So if you are interested, and if you want to participate in translating data first, and if you want to attend the training sessions, you can send an email to Marion, and she can inform you about our plans. Well, this was basically the main things, and I think there is now time for questions. I'll stop share my screen now. Let me see if it works.
Um,
Thank you, Laura. Irena, is it possible to unmute everyone or that they mute themselves? And if they would like to have a question, then that they ask questions via the mic?
Yes, hello everyone. So I can unmute, I think, a person. So if there's somebody that would like to jump in or communicate, do let me know. Either they can raise the hand or just put it in the chat.
Yeah. I go to the Q&A because there were questions asked in the Q&A, there were questions asked in the chat. So I first go to the Q&A, and there was a question of Rory McNeil. And he said, thank you for the presentation. Could you please comment on how this relates to the EOSC? Are there plans to deploy Dataverse on the EOSC or other ways in which Dataverse will be involved in the EOSC? Thank you for your question, Rory. Yeah, so at the moment we are building Dataverse on the Google Cloud of CESDA, and there are also plans to make a Daria service, so a service that can be used by several institutes or several service providers, or several research groups. But it is also possible that if people would like to run Dataverse on their own servers, that we have a so-called archive in a box solution, so that it's possible to on the marketplace to download the adapted version of Dataverse, so with a translated user interface and with linkage to specific European controlled vocabularies, and to download that for an institute and then to deploy it on their own server. So both models are possible, and we will work next year on which model would be a favorite, or if people would, institutes would have both models. So a central model on one of the ERICs, or an individual model that an institute can download themselves. I hope that this answers your question. Then I go back to the chat, and there was one question of Gregor Silbert about confirmation emails, that because Weblate needs a confirmation email, otherwise you can't log in, so that there needs to be communication, but this is solved now. So we now have for the shock project, we have one Weblate instance available at the CESDA, in the CESDA environment. So if you would like to join us, please send of testers, please send Laura or me an email. Then there was a question from Yin Chen. What is the technology used for the auto translation? Laura, because I don't understand the question, maybe you can answer this?
I'm not sure what this attendee is asking, because there's not really an auto translation, because you will still have to do the translation yourself. But with Weblate, you have this interface for it that gives you these helpful tools. So it's not really an auto translation.
Yeah. And the only thing is that it is, if someone published, for example, a Canadian French translation in GitHub, you can download that translation in Weblate and you can make use of that translation. So some of the fields should be changed, but you can make use of a lot of translation already done by a Canadian colleague or a Swiss colleague or a French colleague. Yeah. Then there is a question of Tanya about how does Weblate manage situations where the same source string needs to be translated differently in different contexts of the user interface. This happens sometimes in user interface translation that the same translation will not do or would not be understandable. I thought this was something you, that this question should be answered by your adding the screenshot of the web interface, but I think it's a little bit different. Can you answer this?
I can try. I think it also, this depends on how your software is, how these lines are saved in the files. Because if it's a different component, then you can make a different translation of the same string in a different component, if you know what I mean. But if you, I'm not sure, because I think in Dataverse, I see in the chat. Because I think, well, I haven't come across it yet, but maybe it is, but then, let me see if I understand. You mean that if there's one sentence in English, but you need two different translations for it, or?
Tanya, would you like to join us live, perhaps?
No, but I think the question, you can't unmute Tanya. Is it possible? But I think what I think the question, I understand the question.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. So because I've done a fair bit of user interface translation over the years, so this is one of the trickiest issues, that sometimes you have the same phrase or the same word or something that just simply in your own language is yet the different possible translations, and it depends on the context. Mm-hmm. So for example, like data can be translated into Finnish in three different ways or stuff like that. So when you have a phrase and then in one page you would like to translate in this way, and the other one, if you translate it in exactly the same way, it becomes, the users become, what?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. I'm sorry, Laura, go ahead.
No, yeah, I think I understand, but we are in the testing phase and I haven't come across it yet. So if this is how the code of Dataverse works, that you have one string that is used in different places in the user interface, I'm not sure about that, but maybe.
Well, if there's a problem, then it's okay, but. Mm-hmm.
But thank you, because maybe this is good to test. So so we are now, thank you for pointing this to us, because now we are aware that this can happen. So
yeah, and especially if you have the same language that people can download, but maybe in their version of the same language, they might have a different term for this particular issue.
Yeah. So at the moment we don't have came across this issue, but yeah, thank you very much, because it can be an issue and we were not aware of it. So we will have especially attention to this. And there are a couple of questions in the question and answer. Thank you. Can you explain how the Google Cloud of CESDA relates to the overall EOSC? Oh, this is a difficult question for me, because I think, the EOSC marketplace, there you can we can offer services, and Dataverse, or maybe I think a Dataverse for CESDA, a Dataverse for Daria, and a Dataverse for Clarin, and probably also a Dataverse for Eris, will be available on the marketplace for the EOSC. This is my answer, but maybe I don't know. Yeah, I think that's the relation between the EOSC and the dataverse of CESDA and the other ERICs. I hope this answers your question, Rory McNeil, but otherwise, please continue. The next question is from Richard Dennis. What version of dataverse will your archive in a box use? This will be a version 5, but I'm not sure because in which version 5 is already available, Laura? In
5.1.1 is the current version, but we are still will be developing next year. So we have to see if there's another version coming out next year. And well, if that's a stable version, we'll take that one, I guess. But
yeah.
It will be one of the latest versions.
Yeah. One of the latest, but not the latest, because we always would like to be one, not the latest, because there can be some bugs not tested yet. And question of Gregor Siebert. Gregor, thank you for the presentation. I just registered on Weblate. I see the Slovene language is not listed, so I created it. ADB has already been working on Slovenian translations on the CESDA Dataverse AU project in 2018. Is it possible to import those translations to Weblate? I know that there is a few new and changed things since then. Laura, then they have to be published on the GitHub of the...
Yes. I think I think there should be there, but I think because we haven't turned on every GitHub connection, that it may not have found them yet. And also it takes a while for Weblate to import it. So I can take a look at it, but I think it's still there and we can import it.
Yes, so it's not gone, but it's not there at the moment. And a question of Rory McNeil, thanks. So Dataverse will be deployed on multiple ERICs. Yeah, but that's depending on the ERIC. So we know that CESDA really would like to have maybe an archive in a box solution or otherwise a central Dataverse solution for small institutes. And I know that Daria is interested, but yeah. So, if an ERIC would like to have Dataverse available, then please contact me so we can talk with you where we can deploy that. We need a technical infrastructure. So with CESDA, it will be on the CESDA infrastructure. With Daria, it will be possible to do it on the Poznan supercomputing and network center. So therefore we are negotiating with the different ERICs. And I don't know Dara versus back. I don't know what Richard Dennis is referring to. It's a link. I don't click on the link yet because then I'm a little bit afraid I'm totally lost during this session. Richard, can you say a little bit about this? Irene, can you unmute?
Yeah. Yes, you did. Hi, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
I work for University of Copenhagen, and this is our development Dataverse. I've been working with Dataverse since version 3. So I'm intimately knowledgeable of Dataverse, and what you're attempting to do is rather ambitious. and if I could assist and provide you with any guidance, I would be more than happy to lend to support. I think this translation project is quite helpful and meaningful, especially since I'm living in Denmark, but I'm a native speaking English person. So it's an ambitious undertaking, and I have much respect for Dataverse and for anyone who attempts to use the open source product, because it is not a very easy product or open source solution to use.
Hmm. Yeah, so please join our training sessions and we can, so this training session will not only be about training people how to use the Weblate connection to Dataverse, but also will be go into more details how to proceed with the translations and how to solve issues and that kind of thing. So you are welcome. These training sessions will start from February on next year. And I see Q&A now. I think these were all questions until now. Are there other people who have questions? You can also ask other questions about Dataverse. That's not a problem, but.
Would anyone like to add a question live?
So please, if you would like to join us in translating a user interface for your own needs or helping translating us this for the SHOCK project, you are more than welcome to join us. I think I'm not allowed to use the list of attendees because of the GDPR, but so please send me an email or send Laura an email and we will contact you and we will give you more information when we start this training discussion sessions later on from February 2021.
So just to say that slides will be available, and at the end of the slides, there will be an email address of Marion and Laura, and you can contact them that way.
Yeah. No questions. Thank you for attending these sessions. I hope we give you enough information and that it was worthwhile to listen to us. And please contact if you have any questions concerning the translation of the user interface or concerning data for a SHOCK project. I'm more than happy to answer them to you. Thank you all for joining this session.
Closing the session and just welcoming everyone to join us tomorrow for more interesting sessions on different tools and different projects. Thank you and bye.
Bye.